Yontif. Well, it's a great honor to be here tonight. See, I'm a writer. I write books, and it's a lonely profession. You sit with your laptop. Often you're below ground. Don't see a lot of people. And it's nice to get out on the ground and see some human beings. So it's a great pleasure to be here tonight on this special day. I often complain about being a writer, but I really am very blessed to have played a very important role in the editing of the Gutnick Chumash and other publications which have spread Chassidus and Torah to all parts of the globe, really. And it's a humbling thing. And I often remember the story that they tell about writers Gan Eden. That after living 120 years on this planet, the writer goes up to the netherworld. And they tell him, and he asks, am I going to go to Gan Eden? Am I going to bathe in the glory of the Shekhinah for eternity, of the Divine Presence? Or am I going to go to the other place, to purgatory, where it's rather unpleasant, to say the least? So they check out the computer. I always imagine standing there as a little bit like checking into, you know, when checking into an airplane flight. They're checking in the computer, see where your reservation is. And they say to him, you know, your file's been lost. It's going to take a while to retrieve it. Why don't you go and check out Writer's Gan Eden and check out Writer's Gehinnom, and you'll get a feel to what they're like. When you've seen them, you can come back here. We'll tell you where you're going. So he goes down the corridor to Writer's Gan Eden, and he sees a huge room like this, a huge, huge room. And there's thousands of writers, and he thinks, well, they are all chained to their desks, and they're writing away. So he thinks, well, that's Gan Eden. I wonder what Gehinnom's like. So he goes down the corridor to Gehinnom, and it's exactly the same thing. There's thousands of writers, and they're all chained to their desks, and they're writing away. And he looks at the door, Gehinnom. He goes back, writes Gan Eden. Exactly the same thing. So he goes back to the angel. And he said, I'm rather confused here. You told me here's Gan Eden, you told me here's Gehinnom. I look in there, it's just both are the same thing. There's thousands of writers tied to their desk, typing away. What's the difference? And the angel replies, in Gan Eden they get published. This story resonates with me because writing, even when you're successful, is a lonely profession. You sit there and you write away. And God helps, you get published and your work gets out there, but it's always a pleasure to meet people who use your books. And I know that Rabbi Kanalski was telling me in his shul, it's one of the books you use. It's always exciting to meet the people who use it. It was a couple of weeks ago that I met a shliach who was here for the Kislev shluchim. And the story that he told me really helped me to live righteous Gan Eden on earth. Listen to this. As we celebrate it as Kislev. Shliach from a place called, this is a town called Arcata, California.
Arcata,
A-R-C-A-T-A. Oh. It's a small town. It's 300 miles north of San Francisco. Its population is 17,321. And you know, when you're a young Lubavitcher couple nowadays, you're looking to go out and do the Rebbe's work on Shlichus, there's not many places left. Thank God Chabad has the globe covered. You haven't yet touched the moon or other planets. When it comes to planet Earth, there aren't many places where Jews live that there's no Shliach. So this young couple, younger man, I was speaking with a couple of weeks ago, told me they're looking for a place to go. And they see on the map, Arcata, California, no one there. Let's go there. There's 17,000 people there. Not 17,000 Jews. 17,000 people. I checked on Google today the percentage of Jewish population in Arcata, California is 0.25%.
Goodness above ever.
Which means that, according to my simple calculation, there are 43.7 Jews in Arcata, California. And this young fellow is called Reb Elio Cowan. He's gone out in Shlichus. And he tells me he just moved there a few months ago. And he's walking around. Someone comes up and says, "Hey, Rabbi, nice to see you here. What are you doing in Arcata? Not many Jews here. You aren't here on business?" So he says, No, I've just moved here. I'm the new Chabad Shliach." And the fellow says back to him, "Chabad Shliach in Arcata, California? Wow! That's unbelievable. I mean, you know, there's not a lot of us Jews here. There's only 43.7 of us. I'm the 0.7. So he replies, "Well, you know, maybe you'd like to come to my house for Shabbos." So the guy says, "You know what? We're already very familiar with Chabad here. I learn the essays of Rabbi Schneerson every week. And we have a class together. We all study Chabad." The Shliach can't believe his eyes. 43 Jews here, there's already a class. He says, "What do you mean?" So he says, "Yeah, we have a study group in the Gutnick Chumash." And I heard that and I felt, that is right as Gan Eden on earth. Imagine, you know. And he told me it's so much easier to go on Shlichus when the guy's already learning Chassidus there. This is right as Gan Eden on earth. What a schus it is to spread Chassidus. And we're all part of that. All of us who daven at Chabad, contribute to Chabad, learn the Chassidus of Chabad, we're all part of this tremendous, tremendous movement of spreading the most wonderful wisdom to the world, which we're celebrating tonight. Before I start the Dvar Torah, I'd like to give a special thank you to Rabbi Mrs. Lubowick here tonight, who opened the door for Writers Gan Eden for me. When I was a young, unknown yeshiva bacha in Tiferes Bechurim in Morristown, New Jersey, they commissioned me for my first writing project, which was a guide to the laws of Korban Pesach and a guide to the laws of Bikurim, which is still in print. And I thank you to you both for sending me on this path. Young boy, young teenage boy, growing up in London. How did I get into this Chassidus Chabad? I was a very unlikely candidate to do this. Young English boy. By the age of 13, I was deeply alienated by Judaism. Any of you been to England? Have you been to England?
I'm sure you remember me.
Huh?
Remember me 20 years ago?
What's your name?
Manchester.
Oh, yes.
I remember you used to come to the yeshiva.
Yeah.
Where's your friend?
He's around. So I grew up in London. Now, if any of you know anything about England, it's very, very formal. It's extremely formal. Chaim just mentioned I have a friend in London called Eliezer Shear, who's a lawyer. And he was learning what's called the bar exam in London to become an English lawyer. And to do that, he became a Lubavitcher Chassid, same time as me, and we went to Morristown together. To do the bar in London, you have to do 26 dinners. You have to go and eat dinner at the bar 26 times. And because he was religious, he'd arrange kosher food. And this is just an insight how formal England is. He went to this dinner. It was a very hot day. It was about 90 degrees. And in England, no one has any air conditioning. Because, you know, if it's hot, you just sit and suffer. You don't stiff upper lip. You don't say anything. And everyone in there is glowing and dripping. And there's this young Jewish boy, this young chassid. So he's hot, so he takes off his jacket. And the master of ceremonies comes up to him. He's on this line. They all wear kapotas there, by the way. It's called a Prince Albert. And he comes up to him in his Prince Albert. And he says, "Excuse me, sir. You may not remove your jacket until the Lord Chancellor has removed his jacket. Kindly replace your jacket." So, having been to yeshiva, my friend was a well-trained chutzpinyak. And since the food was so bad, he'd already drank a few l'chaims. So he said back to the master of ceremonies, "Well, in that case, could you tell the Lord Chancellor to remove his jacket, because I'm rather hot." And of course, this master of ceremonies is just simply following orders.
Well, he was American.
And he goes back to the Lord Chancellor, whispers something in his ear, and then he's coming back to my friend. The Lord Chancellor still has his jacket on. And he says, this is the truth, it's 100% true story. He says to him, "The Lord Chancellor says that no Lord Chancellor has removed his jacket at a bar dinner since 1623. And he does not wish to be the first to break this precedent." So that's a little bit of a taste of the culture that I grew up in. And England, the jury is the same. English Judaism is about deathly formality. All I remember sitting in shul, we didn't go that much, but all I remember sitting in shul is you stand up, you sit down, you stand up, you sit down, you're just following everyone else. And I found it the soul-destroying experience. And by my bar mitzvah, in those days they still used to do fire and brimstone. Like when you would come to shul, the rabbi would give this whole speech, "Why aren't you in shul every week?" And he would like criticize the congregation and give them words of threats. You know, if you don't come to synagogue, the whole place is going to fall apart. And I didn't go very much. So I came to my bar mitzvah. He knew our family didn't go too much. It was Orthodox shul, but we just weren't that interested. And he gives this whole speech, "If you don't come next week, if you don't come back to synagogue next week," he says in this upper crust English voice, "then your entire bar mitzvah is a waste of time. And your entire Jewish education is a waste of time." And he gave this whole critique. Now, I'm not one to respond to emotional blackmail. So the next morning I was sitting in bed, next Shabbos morning I was lying in bed, rolled over, saw it was about 9:30, time to go to shul. And I remembered the rabbi's speech, "If you don't come to the synagogue, your entire Judaism's a waste of time." And I thought to myself, and I rolled back to sleep. I didn't enter a synagogue again for about another 5 years after that. Until I stumbled on Chassidus. And I didn't stumble straight away upon Chassidus. I actually came through the Rambam. The Rambam was Makai. I was in Leeds University in England. I was studying medicine. And I was getting bored. Because I don't want to get into a whole rant about medicine now, Western medicine. But it all seemed too mechanical to me. It was all about numbers. Whenever I go to my doctor, he always tells me the same thing. "You're too fat. You have to lose weight." And I always bite my tongue, because the guy's fatter than me. In Western medicine, it all boils down to a number. You know, we have your weight, your blood sugar. It's too mechanical. It's like being a car mechanic. I wanted to learn about the healing, about the spirit, about the human being as an entire organism. I wasn't getting it. So I started to go to philosophy lectures, started to talk about the meaning of life. One day I'm in Leeds University bookstore, and I'm looking at the greats, Aristotle, Plato, looking at the philosophy section, and the more later philosophers, Kant, thinking which to buy. And I see there Maimonides. I think to myself, yeah, that's cool. Someone Jewish. So, and it really, I think this was the most defining moment in my return to Yiddishkeit. It suddenly dawned on me, someone Jewish has something intelligent to say. That's so bizarre. I just remember the synagogue as being this rabbi telling you if you don't come next week, you're a loser. The food is atrocious. The wine in England was called Palwin 4A. I don't know if you can buy it here. It's probably gone out of business by now. But it's something that for sacramental purposes only. Because there was no way you would ever drink it. It was on a mitzvah. And the cookies at the kiddush were just like, they turn into powder in your mouth. Judaism for me was just this horrible experience. And I'm standing there in the bookstore, I'm looking for the meaning of life. And I think to myself, Judaism? That's even an option? That Judaism has something meaningful to say? Something to address the spirit? Something to address the mind? So I bought Maimonides' Guide from the place. And I read the whole thing. And I didn't understand it. But I did admit to myself that I didn't understand. I was enjoying the idea of it. And this was really a primer for me. That when I would finally encounter Chassidus with the Shluchim in London, and through the Ivy League program, by the Heft family here in New York, when I'd finally meet Chassidus, it would be an instant love affair. Because you know that old story about the wind and the sun? They're trying to get the guy to get rid of the coat. The wind and the sun have a competition. It's a story you always hear at yeshiva. And the wind says to the sun, watch me. I know this story is in bad taste. Because after I know how New Jersey was ravaged by Hurricane Sandy, while we were sitting in Crown Heights, just enjoying. We were pretty much unaffected. I know you were pretty badly affected here, and definitely in surrounding areas. But the wind had this competition. He says, I'm going to get the guy to get the coat off. And he starts to blow and blow. This guy's just bought his new leather jacket. He's not losing it so quickly. And he's blowing and it's flapping in the wind. And the wind says, hey, that's unusual. Normally this level, not normally a tropical storm, the guy's coat's off by now. Let's turn it up to a grade one hurricane. And the wind's blowing 75 miles an hour wind. And finally the guy's jacket comes off. But he just bought it for $300. So he grabs onto it. Yeah, and the wind's blowing and blowing. No use. So the sun says, hey, Mr. Wind, stop for 5 minutes. I'll show you how to do this. And the wind abates. The guy puts on his jacket again. It's starting to get hot. He's getting hot. Whoa. I need this jacket. Takes it off. The sun says, see? All that blowing doesn't help. This is a story that's bought to explain what Chassidus achieved. Judaism for so long, what I experienced in England was something that Jews for centuries were experiencing. A judgmental Judaism. An angry Judaism. An elitist Judaism. Chassidus comes along, gives us a little bit of warmth in Judaism. Say, you know what? You're all right. Even if you don't come to shul next week, you know what? You're a Jew. Celebrate it. Do what you can. Sin for praying. Say the Chaim. Do a little bit more if you can. With that kind of attitude that Chassidus brought to us, Judaism has had an utter revolution. You know, there was a thinker in the 20th century called Chaim Zimmerman who made the following observation. He said, originally, the Talmidei Chachamim, the Torah scholars, were happy. And the simple people were miserable. Why? Because Judaism was elitist. If you had knowledge, if you were a Torah scholar and you knew the Talmud, then you were respected. People stood up when you walked in the room. You were allowed to pray in a respectable synagogue. But if you were an uneducated Jew, and all you knew how to do was just read the prayer book in Hebrew, or even just in Russian, and that's all you knew how to do, then you couldn't even daven in the shul of the scholars. And you had to go to the simple guy's shul. No one cared about you. So originally, said Chaim Zimmerman, the Torah scholars were joyous and the simple people were miserable. Then came Rabbi Yisrael Salanter, the Musa movement. And the Musa movement taught us introspection. It taught us to be harsh on ourselves. It focused on punishments. And then said Rabbi Chaim Zimmerman, the Torah scholars were miserable because they were constantly focusing on Musa. And the simple people were still miserable. He said, then came Rabbi Yisrael Baal Shem Tov and taught that even the simple yid is close to God. You just say Baruch Hashem, that makes Hashem more happy than anything else in the world. So he said, then the Torah scholars remained miserable, and now the simple people are happy. Yutes Kislev, this is such a powerful day. It's the Rosh Hashanah of Chassidus. It's the day when we renew and we celebrate our attachment to this wonderful, wonderful wisdom. And the wonderful, wonderful teachers, our blessed Rebbeim, who brought this wisdom into the world and sacrificed any pleasure that they might have had from this world in order that we should have today a legacy of Teres HaChassidus, of the wisdom of the Baal Shem Tov, and particularly the wisdom of the Alter Rebbe, Rabbi Shmuel Zalman of Ladi, whose redemption we celebrate tonight. How does Chassidus affect our lives? And what can we do with it? Why is it so important? So I've told you a little bit of my personal feelings, how Chassidus was really the light of Judaism for me personally. But I think that having spent now thousands of hours poring through the texts, there's a secular writer called Malcolm Gladwell, who recently wrote, he's a journalist who writes about scientific wisdom, sums it up very brilliantly. And in his recent book, Outliers, he suggests that anyone can become an expert in any field. You don't actually have to be a genius if you just spend 10,000 hours focusing on a particular expertise. And actually, if you're too smart, it doesn't help. The geniuses of this world we don't even know about. They're just sitting in a room playing with an iPad somewhere. We just don't know about it. As long as you have some measure of intelligence, if you spend 10,000 hours on a doctrine, on a topic, you will become a master. Now, I have to tell you, I've done my 10,000 hours of chassidus. I don't mean to boast, it's just that's what I do for a living. I get paid for it, to study chassidus and to share with others. And I'd like to sum up, if you would ask me standing on one leg, the Alter Rebbe came out of jail today. And that means we have Chassidic wisdom, otherwise it would have been lost, God forbid. What would we be lacking without Chassidus? In terms of attitude, in terms of how to worship God, what would we be lacking? We have the Rambam, we have the Zohar, we have all the Rishayim, we have the Gemara. There's wonderful, wonderful Jewish texts. You could spend 100,000 hours studying Judaism and never even touch Chassidus. Why is it so significant that in heaven on this very night it was decided that the wisdom of Rabbi Shmuel Zalman of Liadi and his children and his successors should be shared with Klal Yisrael, and this wisdom would bring us to the coming of Mashiach? Why was that decided? Have you ever thought about that? I think about this a lot. What is so special about what we're doing? And I'd like to share with you an insight which I think sums up what Chassidus achieved. You see, let's take the Rambam, Maimonides, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, 12th century Jewish scholar. He lived in Spain, he lived in Egypt. The Rambam is considered to be the foremost Jewish thinker of history. One person who stands out as the great Jewish intellectual, the great thinker. The Rambam rewrote the Talmud. He took the huge volumes of Talmud and he rewrote them into 14 books called the Mishnah Torah, the Yad Hachzaka, his Code of Law. He literally rewrote the entire Judaism. But there's one area where the Rambam made it difficult to be a Jew. And that is in the way he understood God. Let's get back to that guy from the Plex, that thing I bought in Leeds University 20 years ago. If you read that book, the Rambam's a philosopher. And he poses the question, what can we say about God? What can we say about God? So, of course, we're tempted to say he's very wise. He knows everything. He's infinitely kind. But the Rambam as a philosopher says, no. We are mere mortals. We're human beings. We can't say God is wise. You know why? Because when we say wise, what do we mean? We think someone who knows how to read the Talmud well, someone who has a lot of wisdom, someone who knows which cell phone plan to buy. That's wisdom. Human mortal wisdom. You can't attribute that to God. Divine wisdom is something that we can't even describe. Kindness. What's human kindness? Give it. You help someone across the road, give a poor person a meal. Give $1 million to charity. God is infinite. There's nothing we can say in the human vocabulary which is going to describe God's kindness. So Rambam, Maimonides, he comes to this conclusion. What can we say about God? Absolutely nothing. There's nothing you can say about him. You can say he's not mean. You could say in the negative, he's not stupid. He's not lacking in wisdom, but there's nothing you can actually say about him. So while the Rambam left us this tremendously wonderful, wonderful legacy, he made God distant. The Eibishter became the unspeakable, the unknowable. He made God very, very distant from us. And that makes it difficult to be a Jew. If there's nothing you can say about God, then what are you going to do? 100 years after the Rambam died, the Zohar was revealed, the fundamental text of Jewish mysticism. And if you read the Zohar, and please do read the Zohar, I know we're Chassidim, we tend to read only Chassidus because that's our loyalty. But the Rebbeim very much, especially the Rebbe, wanted that we should study Zohar and study all the texts of Jewish mysticism. The Rebbe's father, of course, was a famous author of commentaries on the Zohar. If you read the Zohar, I mean, if the Rambam, there's a whole debate whether the Rambam saw the Zohar. But if you read the Zohar, it's the complete opposite. It talks about God's arm and his leg, and he's in a different mood today, and how long is it between his nose and his navel, and all this kind of stuff. And there's angels gushing up and down, godliness flooding into the universe. You get the impression that God is right here. He's complex and he's confusing, but what can you say about him? Anything you want. You can call him your lover. You can call him all sorts of strange terms used for God in the Zohar. And all sorts of assistance that he has. It's very, very complex. Is God distant or is he close? I would like to suggest that the Alter Rebbe, Rabbi Shlomo Zalman of Liadi, solved this problem for us. He took both of these systems. The Alter Rebbe had a neshama chadasha. He had a new soul. Most of us have recycled souls. Our souls have been here many times before. But the